beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, take a look in the 5 and 10,
glistening once again,
with candy canes and silver lanes aglow. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Oh, yes, 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 indeed. It is beginning to feel a lot like Christmas in June this year as we finally, and hopefully start the long climb out of lockdown. And that's a great reason to look forward and try to guess what the future could, might, or will look like. And this episode 32 of That Great Business Show with me, Conall O Morain.
ThatGreatBusinessShow.com is brought to you by De Facto Shaving Oil, the best anyone can get. Made in Ireland, sold worldwide.
In a minute, we'll have a business that went from making sandwiches from bread to making bread with boxes. We'll explain that later on. We have an incredible business that looks set to revolutionise how we train pilots, offshore wind technicians, indeed anybody doing hazardous work. Iconic store Arnott's wants to show off your products to their 6 million annual shoppers, and they're giving all kinds of supports to get the best into their store in time for the real Christmas rush, not the June one. And the angels are here to tell us what's attracting investment money at the moment, and maybe how you can get your mitts on some. As always, we ask you to follow us on our LinkedIn pages, where you will learn more about the show. You'll get our weekly sneak peek of what's coming up, and we've now added regular tips and insights gleaned from our great guests on That Great Business Show. And remember, your company or any company being on That Great Business Show is only possible because another great company, that's our super sponsor De Facto, makers of the world's best shaving oils, support us. Support them by buying the best shaving oil anyone can get at defactoshave.com.
That Great Business Show.
Now, regular listeners know we've had a load of food and drinks companies on the podcast as they relaunch, reinvent, or reimagine themselves and their products. I'm pretty sure that retail shopping has changed forever, that we'll continue to buy hats and hammers online. And we had Lane Doyle of Dundeal on episode 11, and she was pretty adamant the majority of car sales were heading online. But what about prepared food? What's the future of your local deli or even the more humble sandwich shop? Jeananne O'Brien of Eatto has been there and done that when it comes to food preparation. And prepared meals is what she's betting the future on mostly. Welcome to That Great Business Show, Jeananne.
Hi, how are you?
You sound very quiet and nervous. You're not meant to be nervous on That Great Business Show, because we are here to pick your brains about the future. Easy.
Oh, yeah.
What's going to happen?
I'll just get my crystal ball. Yeah.
Well, let's go back a little bit, because just to give a little bit of sense of how deep your roots are in the food business. For example, I've only just found out that it all started in San Francisco.
Yeah, I suppose it did. It goes back to artisan, which I was living over in the US, over in San Francisco, probably back 16 years ago, 17 years ago now. And I decided to set up a deli here in Ireland. So I came home and I had, you know, spotted sourdough, and the way the food was in the US was unbelievable, especially in California, obviously. So my plan was to bring that here, and I did. I opened a small deli on Leeson Street, and then gradually over the years we expanded in retail, and then we decided we were going to move out of retail, and because we were heavily in corporate catering, and that's what we're in.
And hold that today. Thought, because yeah. I want everybody to understand that your knowledge of catering was huge, because you had done a BCom and you had done a Smurfy degree in marketing and you had gone into corporate finance.
Mm-hmm.
You had nothing at all.
I didn't. My mother was a home economics teacher. So I had...
It's allied, but it's not the same.
I had grown up with food around me, so from a very young age... So I would have done a lot at home with my mom. But you're absolutely right. I mean, I suppose I learned in San Francisco. I just decided to, I remember seeing this amazing deli down in the financial district in San Francisco. And I would ring the owner every day and I would ask him, have you any jobs? And he'd say, nothing still, Jeananne, nothing. And I'm like, okay, I'll just take whatever hours you can give me. So I remember he rang me and he gave me a couple of lunchtime shifts and then he gave me Saturday morning. And I thought, ah, come on, you know, I wanted to go out on Friday night. But sure, anyway, I lived with it and I was up at the crack of dawn doing Saturday morning.
And you probably worked out at Friday night as well.
I did too, yeah. So that's kind of how I learned very much in at the deep end, just learned the business and learned about food. And I suppose I loved food. I had a real passion for that. And then I just put the business with it. And that was how it started.
And why the jump out of retail into the corporate market?
Well, I suppose we were, you know, Leeson Street was very much a retail store. It was all retail, a couple of kind of small orders for catering. Then we opened on Baggot Street. We opened in the old Parsons building. I don't know if you remember, in the corner of Baggot Street. We opened there and it's funny, it was like a billboard. It was always, and people used to say to me, no one will cross the street. It's the wrong location. And they were absolutely right. From a retail perspective, it wasn't anywhere near Leeson Street yet. It was three times the size of the Leeson Street store. But the corporate catering just kicked off from there.
Because they saw the name.
Because they saw the name. And so from there, we started doing, you know, platters of sandwiches and you know, the normal stuff you'd find in a boardroom. Sandwiches, soups, salads, all of that kind of stuff, fruit. And we were delivering that. And then it got too big. We couldn't cope with the customers coming in the door and us trying to get catering out the door. So
great complaint to have.
It was great, yeah. So we moved down to Reuben Street, just straight opposite the Coombe Hospital, yep, there down in Dublin 8. And we had a great home there for a number of years. And we thought, we're all set here now. We'll never need anywhere bigger. And we'll be, this is super. And so we started to do our catering from there. And that was grand. We were traveling in and out. And then we got busier and busier. And then one day somebody said, do you guys do hot food? And I said, oh, yes. Yes, we do. And
well, was that an honest answer or was that a business person's answer?
Well, we did soup, but okay, you know, so I wasn't lying, but I wasn't. They said, oh, it's just that we have a gig coming up for a tender and would you like to present? Oh, we would, yeah. And so anyway, I remember I called my mother and she came in and we had a chef who came in at the weekends and he would do soup. And we presented what we had and they said, okay, well, we're not sure. We'll give you a couple of weeks trial. We had been working with them, but doing sandwiches and all of this kind of stuff. So we just adapted very quickly and did what we could. And they were like, oh, no, this is fantastic. And that was our first kind of, you know, experience into hot food delivering. And that was 10 or 12 years ago. So people talk about cloud kitchens today. Like, it was a long time ago this was happening, but people didn't realize.
And
you know?
Better explain to those who don't know what the concept of the hot cloud kitchen is.
Yeah. So I suppose a cloud kitchen is where companies didn't have a full kitchen to feed their staff on site. Some companies didn't have the space. Some companies didn't want to invest in a kitchen. And so what we would do is we would cook everything off site and bring it in a just-in-time nature, which meant it was coming in hot. And that, you know, we were doing it from 25 people. And in the end, like, you know, we do it for thousands now where literally we just, you know, have to bring in breakfast, lunch and dinner for, you know, 2,000 people, which is a logistical nightmare.
I think we agreed a challenge.
We did, but it's still a nightmare. Yeah. But no, it's a challenge and we're good at it, you know, so we're used to it. And I suppose, as I always say to the guys, the difference is we grew up with it. We didn't go from zero to 2,000 in one go. We went to 70 to 90, you know, and we gradually worked our way up.
Which is fantastic because you also, and again, we'll talk pre-COVID and post-COVID. Pre-COVID, you were about, what, 200 and?
Yeah, so we were about 220 staff pre-COVID. And that was very much like we run in-house kitchens as well now.
In a big unit? You have a very big unit.
Yeah. So, well, we moved again. We moved out of Reuben Street because we did grow out of it. And we moved out to just out to the Nace Road there near the Red Cow. And we have 26,000 square feet out there now, which is big. Yeah. And so now that's our cloud kitchen from there. And we still deliver in to a lot of the tech world. We do a lot of their catering. And then we also would have in-house kitchens. And, you know, it was the classic story of, you know, we'd go for a tender and it was, you're too small. What do you mean we're too small? Well, you don't have another site that's 300 or 400 people. And yeah, but if you don't give me a chance, I won't, you know.
You hate that.
You know, it's a vicious circle. So eventually someone takes a bet on you and they go, you know what, I think you can do it. So
any tips to people on how to break that cycle?
Oh yeah, it's hard work. It's day in, day out, and it's I think it's quality. It's and then it comes down to relationships. It always comes down to relationships, and you know, effectively, you know, we still are. We're all about the customer and delivering the highest quality food, and that's what we do. So it didn't matter if it was a sandwich; it was the best sandwich in town, and that was the difference. So we just transferred that over to doing the best food in town in the corporate world.
What attracted my attention to you, besides your friend Paula Fitzsimons, is the new thing that you're doing, which I personally thought was very clever, delivering meals to people.
Yeah.
Now, that sounds very obvious.
Yeah.
But tell the listeners the very different way or different thing that you're doing.
Well, I suppose what was happening was, you know, a lot of people have thought this was a pivot for COVID, but in reality, it wasn't. It was, I suppose, 18 months out, 2 years out from COVID. I was coming home. I have three smallies at home, and I was coming home and I had no dinner, which seems unrealistic when you had a catering company that was feeding how many people. But I wouldn't have been on the floor in the kitchen. I would have been in an office. So I wasn't, you know, thinking, what's for dinner, until I walked in the door and then I was asked what's for dinner. I always used to say, if I just had the protein element of the meal, like say the meatballs in a tomato sauce or something, you'd always have spaghetti in your press or things like that, some frozen peas. As a company, we're part of Origin Green. I don't know if you've heard of Board B as Origin Green. It's Ireland's sustainability program.
I know it very well. I'm doing podcasts for them.
Ah, are you? Yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. And we had signed up for Artisan, and it's our 5-year program for us on our sustainability. And so when we started Eatto, it was very much sustainability was at the heart of it. And so that's why it's frozen. Because, you know, we're all about cutting down on waste and, you know, so many people buy food in for the week, then don't get around to cooking it and then you open the drawer and it's gone off and you're going, oh my God. So that's what we did. We started with, you know, a number of main courses and then realized, well, maybe we should add sides. And then we said, well, if we're at it, should we add desserts? And sure, suddenly I think we've 64 different things on the menu. But yeah, so it's been, when COVID hit, I suppose we had the time, but we also had the team, and we were able to turn around and say, right, let's shift focus entirely. You know, the website was built. We were at that point.
It looks very well.
It wasn't. It wasn't finished, you know.
One of the offers that you have, which I thought was really clever, is that you will feed post-pregnant mummies or mothers. Which I thought was just, that's a nice idea.
Yeah.
And also you have congratulations meals and stuff like that.
Yeah. I mean, it's, I suppose, you know, when the coming home from hospital was very much a kind of, you know, you haven't time to do anything. And so what we have found is it's been a very general response, which I was chatting to you about. It's been unbelievable across different markets. But one of the big gifting things is, of course, you also find a lot of mothers are buying it for themselves even pre-going into hospital, if that makes sense, because they know then everyone's set at home and they don't need to worry. It's in the freezer, just take it out, very clear instructions on how to cook it. So from that point of view, it's worked very well. It's so interesting. We have seen a lot of the diaspora actually be like, I was in a conversation with somebody from New Zealand the other day, couldn't get home to her sister and wanted to send a box because she wasn't well. You know, we have people feeding their parents.
That's a lovely idea.
It's brilliant, you know.
And I know you're going to continue with the corporate catering.
Yeah.
Is the box business going to continue post-COVID? Because hopefully we are coming out of COVID.
Yeah, I think we are. I'm really hopeful. I mean, we're definitely seeing positive signs. We have clients coming back on the artisan side who are beginning to chat to us again and go, right, you know, let's make a plan. So that's really positive. With Eatto, I mean, as I said to you, it was never really about COVID, but it was unbelievable for the year we had. We were very lucky because it meant we all had something to do. So now actually Eatto is going out on its own and the team is being built out to make sure it is ready to go on its own. And, as Artisan comes back into play. So it will continue. Sure, it's going from strength to strength. So I hope now we can grow that in its own right.
And you mentioned the diaspora. And I was hoping you were going to tell me that there were people from New Zealand or from wheresoever ringing you up to see whether you could ship them food from here to there.
We've had it. Yeah, we've had questions from the US.
Can you do it?
I'm laughing. We could do it if people want to pay for it. But it's, you know, the reality
the
is it's a different ball game at the moment. So no, our focus is very much on Ireland for the next 12 months to grow, to see where we get to in the next 12 months. And then we'll see where we go from there.
But that's the bit I want to hear.
Yeah.
What goes after 12 months? What's the next one?
Well, we have to prove the concept. Like we've done very well in the first, to give you an idea, we launched in April. We did a soft launch. We didn't tell anyone. It was open over the summer because we wanted to get the distribution right. We're shipping frozen product straight to your door that has to arrive frozen and go into your freezer. So that was no mean feat in itself to get that right. And also our packaging is 100% compostable, which isn't being done by, I don't know who's doing it. It's 100% compostable. So it goes straight in your brown bin after you cook the food, including the film. And so that all came with its challenges. So over those 3 months, we kind of gradually, ironed out any kinks. And then from September, we grew and then very well. And then December was an interesting month because, of course, as I call it, we like routine. We December, there's no routine. And equally at Easter, there's no routine. So it's the 2 weeks at Easter. So I think we follow the school calendar. If that makes sense.
It makes a lot of sense because we have found something quite similar, oddly enough, with podcasting, is our figures wobble over holidays. They spike on some days and other days, like nothing. Because you can follow everything on digital, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's very interesting. So, my aim this year is to, you know, finish out the year. Then I will see the peaks and troughs of the year and how we're going. But we're growing at a very fast pace. So I want to watch the next year, focus on that. And then we'll, you know, I have some ideas, but we're...
Come on. You're now Team GBS. You have to share.
They all laugh at me because they're like, oh my God, no, what are we doing now? You know?
Okay, here's a gentler question for you. Where do you think up these fabulous ideas?
Oh,
I do mine in the shower.
Yeah, I wonder about the shower. I think it's that you've been sleeping all night and your brain is working on it and then you're subconscious and then suddenly you're in the shower and everything seems like it's a great idea. I don't know. My poor husband, he'd say I'm never switched off and coming up with something new. And I think you need to because, I mean, with the likes of Eatto, that was in the background because I used to say to the guys inside, look, we just need to be careful. You know, we need to make sure we're doing fantastically well, but we need to make sure that we've a very big production facility. If anything were ever to go wrong, we need to be able to fill that facility. Like no one could have foreseen though what was going to happen, you know.
I understand. Come here to me before I let you go. Hire in a heartbeat. Who would you hire in a heartbeat?
I suppose I was thinking about this. One lady, I'm not sure if you've heard of her, Holly Tucker in the UK. She have you heard of Knot on the High Street?
Yes,
set that up.
Okay.
I suppose she's just extremely dynamic, but and I think she moves at a very fast pace as well. But what I would say is, you know, she set up another company now, Holly & Co. And it's really interesting for people who are starting out and for businesses who are starting out, because it's giving all her insights and her helping small businesses. And I think it's really interesting, like little tips from, you know, top 10 things for scaling, how you scale a business. And she's giving really, really valuable information that, like, people didn't have access to, like all these podcasts. It's amazing, you know, and that wasn't there 15 or 20 years ago where you could get all this information. So
there wasn't,
it's really interesting.
That Great Business Show even 32 episodes ago. This is episode 32. So of course, this is what we're here for as well.
Yeah.
And we will chase down Ms. Tucker and see whether she might have a chat with us now that things are lifting, I think. Yeah. We're going to have to leave it there, unfortunately. That is Jeananne O'Brien of Eatto. Thank you so much for joining us on That Great Business Show.
Looking for the best work-life balance? Why not start your new business life in one of Ireland's beautiful Gaeltacht locations? Uadhrás na Gaeltachta has created Ireland's biggest digital hub, G-Tech. High-speed broadband just for you. Cosail no ifnachgat. Your new work-life awaits. Find out more at uadhrás.ie. You're listening to That Great Business Show. ThatGreatBusinessShow.com.
Another item that you should try to avoid buying in your local shop is shaving foam, because they're the worst a man can get. When they're full, they can contain carcinogenic chemicals, and when they're empty, they go straight to landfill because they're non-recyclable. The simple alternative comes from our show sponsor, De Facto Shave. One small bottle of their all-natural shaving oil can last a year. Good for your skin, your pocket, and the environment. They'll ship it to you immediately from defactoshave.com.
Conobio, at That Great Business Show.
Here's a question for you. How do you train an offshore wind technician? When you hardly send them 50 kilometres offshore with a spanner and a packed lunch, that's just not feasible. But it is a question that a Dublin and Gateshead in the UK-based company VRAI may have a solution for. But will you hear where the idea for the company came from? Former Defence Forces officer Pat O'Connor is VRAI's co-founder, and how he thought up the concept came from an absolutely horrific incident. Welcome to That Great Business Show, Pat.
Thank you very much. Great to be here.
Now, I'm sorry about the intro, but when you mentioned it to me, I just went, oh my God. And then a lot of things fell into place. Do you want to just talk us through where you were, what you were doing?
Sure. Yeah, I guess I served for 21 years in the Irish Defence Forces. I was a proud cavalry officer. And my career kind of split in two. There was kind of 10 years working in reconnaissance units. That's what cavalry do these days rather than running around on horses. And 10 years working in the headquarters between communications and strategy roles. But my last operational deployment was to Syria during the civil war there, 2012, 2013. And part of what we did was we used to patrol between a United Nations base in Syria to the crossing point with Israeli-controlled Golan. And we used to pass through the same town almost every day, and it was generally quite a safe town, despite the civil war that was happening around us. But one day, as we approached the town, you know that feeling you get where something is off, you know, hairs in the back of your neck, something in the pit of your stomach. So we decided to do a U-turn at the roundabout in the middle of the town, because we were unarmed observers at the time, seconded to the United Nations. So we did a U-turn in the middle of the town. We went back to base and we decided to do a quick estimate of the situation. And about 30 minutes after we got back to base, the policeman that was at that roundabout that we went around, he was beheaded on a live Twitter stream by an ISIS affiliate. So that evening, and to be honest, when I got back from my deployment, I was thinking, like, how did we know that something was wrong? And you can imagine what people started saying. They were saying things like, that's your gut instinct kicking in, or that's your training kicking in. But like, I guess that didn't sit right, because like, what is gut instinct? And like, what part of your training? Unfortunately, I had no idea how to solve that problem, but I'm fortunate that one of my best friends, Niall Campion, and my co-founder in VRAI, he's a long career working in VFX, in film, and just generally a technology innovator. And he came up with the concept that a number of technologies were maturing at the same time that would allow us to, first of all, recreate these highly hazardous environments, but recreate them in a safe virtual world. And then secondly, use the inherent data capture capability within VR in order to start to measure and evaluate performance. So that's what we did.
Well, that last part of your sentence there, now what does that actually mean in more layman's terms?
Sure. So basically, virtual reality is an incredible way to recreate virtual worlds. You put on a headset and you can be on the moon. You can be, as you said, 100 miles off the north coast of Scotland, climbing a wind turbine the same height as the Eiffel Tower. Or you can be in a military environment from the safety of your home or your office. But what people don't always think about is that same VR headset is essentially an IoT device or an Internet of Thing device, which is capturing a lot of data on what you're doing in that virtual world. And if you think about it in a practical terms, if you're, you know, a training person and you're watching somebody train, really all you can do is give a subjective opinion of what that person is doing. And the only data you can gather is true observation, really. However, in a virtual world, we can gather up to 500,000 data points per minute of virtual reality training.
I remember you saying that to me, and I'm just thinking, that's an awful lot of data.
It's an awful lot of data. And I suppose what's happened is the technologies have matured to give us the computing power available to do that, the cloud technologies available to do that, and the data analytics and even ML algorithms, machine learning algorithms, are now available to let us exploit that data opportunity.
It's, in my naivety, I keep thinking of what you're doing is not dissimilar to the gaming business or the gaming industry now, is that I watch kids, you know, run around battlefields and all. Similar, dissimilar? Am I completely wrong?
So it's similar skill sets and similar people. And actually, interestingly, some of the senior developers who work for our company, they've come from the gaming world. And one of the reasons that they like what they do is because, you know, ultimately gaming is always gaming. But with simulation training, you are preparing somebody for the real world. You're having a real world impact. But yeah, very similar skill sets and very similar technologies involved in creating those virtual worlds.
The applications, from what you've already told me, off air, are vast.
They are. Like for me, this is almost a definition of a dual use technology because obviously my background is military and I can see clear applications how we could train people in a virtual world so that when they go to those high risk environments, like we were peacekeeping with the United Nations, that they're better prepared and they can be safe.
Now you say better prepared, but I'm sure traditionalists will say, it's never the same unless you're in the field.
Yeah. And it's a combination, what they call blended learning. So if you think of pilot training, you can now become a fully fledged commercial airline pilot. And the first time you have passengers in the back of the aircraft is the first time you've flown a real aircraft. You can get fully qualified through simulation.
Can I find out who those people are? Because I'm not going on that aircraft.
And I guess that was our insight, is that simulation training up until recently, it was kind of like, it was only for really super high value jobs. So it was pilots and surgeons, astronauts, some very rare military activities. But we think that the technology has emerged to a point where it's kind of democratizing the simulation. It's now available to everyone. So as you said, we can use it to train military personnel, but the same technology will train an offshore wind technician. The same technology will train someone who's training to deal with a COVID outbreak.
Before you have, I won't say invented, but created your Oculus headset or whatever, whoever owns the headsets, say for your wind turbine technician, how are they actually, as a matter of interest, how are they trained?
Currently, training for offshore wind is quite traditional. So you go to somewhere like the Port of Blyth, which is in the northeast of England, above Gateshead. They have an offshore wind turbine, which is, you know, pretty much onshore, just a couple of yards off.
Okay.
And that's where you train. And that was our realization, quite similar to my time in the military, that you can train as much as you want in Ireland, but it's very different when you get to somewhere like Syria.
And that would have been my point, but previously it is, where, you know, you are in the field. So there's a reason why you're based in Gateshead, and I'll explain later on because we're going to have the British Embassy people in to explain something big that they're doing, trying to attract people to various places outside of London, the UK. The reason you're in Gateshead is?
The reason, it's actually a no-brainer, if I'm honest. So as Brexit was approaching, and if I was trying to sound smart, I'd probably say like our Brexit hedge was to open an office in the UK and stay close to our customers. But genuinely, it was probably a fudge because we didn't know what else to do. But we knew that it made sense to, first of all, stay close to our customers. Second of all, stay in the sixth largest economy in the world. And thirdly, it's right next door. So we established a company in 2019. And what we looked for was a commercial opportunity to justify opening an office. We got that in 2020 when we signed a contract with the UK MOD, Royal Air Force, doing pilot training. And we opened our first office.
You don't just skip over that because that is huge.
Yeah, it was
exciting. To break through, you must have gone through every kind of security clearance and everything like that.
Yeah, like it's a really exciting project and it's still ongoing. But it's essentially, it's through what's called DASA, the Defence and Security Accelerator. So what they're doing is they're looking for just the best technology in the world. They don't really care, you know, where it comes from, as long as it can solve a problem.
Except if it's from Russia, they probably don't really want to.
Yeah, but like, I mean, for example, I think Finland is the second biggest, Finland provides the second largest amount of companies who receive DASA funding. And it's a really interesting approach because, like, if you think about the traditional space race that existed between the great powers previously, I feel quite strongly that that's been replaced by a technology race, essentially. So it's moving towards a point where in the past, large countries would compete on their ability to buy and make large ships and aircraft. I don't think that's the future anymore. I think the future is going to be what nation has the access to the best technology, the best AI, autonomous systems. And all of that is fully dual use. So I think Ireland has an opportunity to focus on what we're good at, which is digital technology, and focus on digital technology in a dual use capacity. Because as I said, Ireland can very easily decide that it wants to go after and become world leaders in simulation training. And that training will train military personnel, but also offshore wind technicians, surgeons, and anyone else who needs it.
And the contract with the Royal Air Force, I think you told me that it is saving them an awful lot of money.
Ultimately, it's time, which is, of course, money. So, I mean, currently, when people, what we're assisting them to do is understand how people learn. So whether you're a pilot in the RAF, or if you're an offshore wind technician, or if you work for the ESB, it's all about understanding how people learn and what the virtual reality simulated world allows you to do is measure how people learn, measure generally how people learn, and understand how you can get people from novice to expert in a quicker way. And that's what's very exciting about VR. It can really give insights that aren't available anywhere else.
And they're not burning fuel.
Absolutely. So it's interesting, actually, there's a big move towards kind of net carbon neutral across aviation and aerospace. And if you think about, these are people who burn jet fuel for a living. So one of the key ways they can reduce their carbon footprint is to move to a simulated training world. So you stop burning fuel and you train in a virtual world. And like I was a unit commander, a reconnaissance unit commander, and I can assure you, like, running large scale exercises, they're also really difficult to do and getting increasingly difficult, as in every military around the world, there's a squeeze on the amount of people available. The platforms, in other words, the vehicles are more rare, they're more expensive, they're more complicated. So if there's a way to make that training more easily accessible and easier to do at a lower cost locally, it means ipso facto, everyone's going to be better trained because they have more access to the training rather than one or two large training exercises a year. You can do it every day.
Back to Gateshead, because there's further reasons why you're in Gateshead.
Yeah. So, I mean, when we were thinking about the UK, I suppose everyone thinks initially about London, and so did we. But we were contacted by the guys in Department of International Trade. So they would be kind of like a mixture of Enterprise Ireland and IDA equivalent. And they brought us over to Gateshead to look at what they had on offer. And we were blown away, to be honest. So, like, Gateshead is kind of like the south side of the river and Newcastle is the north side of the river, for anyone who doesn't know the area. So you can fly in with Ryanair or Aer Lingus every day. There's a metro to bring it to the city centre, or because there's no traffic, you can get a taxi in 10 minutes. It's super. The city is a nice size. It kind of feels quite, you know, I love London, but it doesn't quite feel like home. Whereas if I go somewhere like Newcastle or Gateshead, it feels quite similar to Ireland. They're producing over 5,000 computer science graduates every year in that region, which is very exciting. off the coast of Newcastle or Gateshead, you have the Dogger Bank, which is the largest offshore wind farm in the world. The UK market is the largest offshore wind market in the world, and the biggest offshore wind farm is right there off the coast. So all the operations and maintenance bases, in other words, the people who would be who would care about training, they happen there. And then the last point was around NICD, which is the National Innovation Centre for Data. So again, the UK have kind of, over the last few months, they've published what they see the future of the UK being post-EU. And what they want to be is a technology superpower rather than any other type of superpower. So the NICD is where they are trying to leverage the data that they're producing across everything that they do to try to generate a competitive advantage to create IP and products they can then sell internationally, which I think is a really interesting model and one that I feel could have a big impact here in Ireland as well if we did the same.
Now, you have raised money and you will be raising more money, I presume. And what's the big plan? Like, you could go massive.
Yeah. Like, if you think about, as probably a lot of your listeners, when COVID hit, we all started working from home and started using Zoom and Teams and Google Meet. And before that, that wasn't really a thing. And I think what's happened is you're seeing an acceleration of digitization of work, or, you know, Industrial Revolution 4.0, whatever you want to call it. And there is no Zoom or Teams or Google Meet for training people. Like, you can do a lecture or a webinar or a meeting, but how do you prepare someone who has to go 100 miles off the north coast of Scotland, climb a turbine that's the same height as the Eiffel Tower, except for it moves 5 meters left to right in waves bigger than your house? You can't prepare for that on Zoom. You need to provide people an option. So yeah, I think the opportunity is huge. I think what we're seeing is that in industries that have a tradition assimilation, so we'll say aerospace, defense, security, medical, that's where the adoption is first. But what we think is that the next industries are going to be ones like offshore wind, which have what we would define risky, remote and rare operational environments. Opportunity is huge. We've raised an initial 1.2 million euros in funding to build out our initial technology stack, which everything else is built on. And now we're back in the market to raise a further 3 million euros, mostly because actually the opportunity is coming faster and bigger than we even predicted.
What a lovely complaint.
It is. It is. And like the flip side of that means that this is now becoming a competitive market. So when we were doing it, people were like, oh, that sounds interesting. Whereas now people see clearly the utility and value. The market is becoming more more crowded. So so we're delighted that we have a niche in terms of our ability to measure, evaluate and predict performance through data. So yeah, looking to raise 3 million euros this year. What we'll use that for is to initially start moving into the US market.
Where I'm hoping to bring you via the Ireland Connecticut Business Council. Anybody who wants to know about doing business in Connecticut, get onto the Ireland Connecticut Business Council website and it'll all explain itself, because Pat, you will be on with us very shortly, I think, on that one. They're waiting for you, because once you crack the US military and Tommy Griffith, who makes more mundane bins over in Mayo, has cracked the US military bases and he's now all over the States. It's incredible.
Yeah, and one of the other reasons why Connecticut is really exciting is because it's also one of the biggest locations for offshore wind. So off the coast of Connecticut, and you can see what's happening in the US with Biden and the move away from fossils towards renewables. It just makes sense. So this is happening. It is the fastest growing job in the US is offshore wind technician. And currently the way it's trained is by a dude in a high-vis vest and a galvanized shed and a ladder. That's not scalable. It's not smart, and it's not going to allow us to train the people we need.
And I don't think it doesn't sound like very good training either.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm sure there's good training, but it's hard to do at a scale. Like, how does one person who knows how to do it train 1,000 people? Because I think if we're going to take advantage of this incredible resource of offshore wind, we need to make sure we have the workforce to do it. And why wouldn't we use technology? It's there, it's available, and it's so impactful.
Who, I mean, presumably take money from anybody legal, who would you really like the money from?
Well, at the moment, we have so far raised our investments through EI and angel investors, and we feel that we're kind of at the point now where bringing in more institutional investors who have deeper pockets, because as you said, the opportunity is huge. We think with our next round, we can start to enter the US. We would see a Series A round then maybe 18 months down the road. So to have an investor on board who A, understands the need for capital to scale into those large markets, but also have done it before. I mean, My background's the military. That's my background. And we're certainly doing our best, but it'd be great to have investors on board who can bring that kind of really deep expertise. It's always great to be around an expert, isn't it? Someone who just are so good at what they do.
Final question. Hire in a heartbeat. Who would you like?
Yeah, I don't want to sound pretentious on it, but so Daniel Pink is a guy myself, my co-founder, do a lot of reading around, and he talks about extrinsic and intrinsic motivation. And for me, it's so core to who we are as humans. We don't react well to carrot and stick. We might for a short time, but then we don't care anymore. We revert back to what we feel ourselves inside. So I think if I could have him on board and make sure that we can create the most dynamic, interesting, exciting, and intrinsically motivating place to be, I think conquer the world.
I had never heard of Mr. Pink before, except for my one of my favorite movies, Reservoir Dogs. Do you remember that?
Mr. Pink.
Mr. Pink. It always makes me laugh. Pat O'Connor of VRAI, Gravmina Magatata Stelcher, That Great Business Show.
Subscribe today to That Great Business Show on your favorite podcast platform, including Apple and Spotify.
Money, or the lack of it, is one of the main drawbacks for very early stage companies in Ireland. There are the usual suspects, such as the Leos, when you're just starting out. You then graduate to Enterprise Ireland, or EI, who in turn will suggest you talk to angel investors. That's where HBAN, or the Halo Business Angels Network, comes in. In 2020, HBAN Angels invested 14 million euro in 59 companies. Good, but definitely not great. John Phelan is All-Ireland Director of HBAN, and he's on a mission to get more people involved in angel investing, and that's why he's joining us today on That Great Business Show. Hiya, John.
Hey, Conall. Thanks for having us.
Sorry to say that 14 million doesn't appear to me to be a big number, but I suppose I get used to looking at numbers in, say, San Francisco or Texas or New York or London, and 14 million quid might buy you half a yacht sometimes.
Yeah, I think we can do better. But I think you put it in perspective. If you think about it, the year before at the HBAN conference, we had a guy called John Harbison, who comes from Tech Coast Angels, who would be one of the biggest US angel groups. And there are about five different groups up and down the West Coast between San Francisco and LA and San Diego. They did that year $19 million as the biggest private group of investors out of the States. And we thought we did $17 million that year. But actually, that wasn't too bad.
That's your way of telling me to shut up.
No, it's good, but we could do better.
What is, it's kind of like a cultural thing. I'm old enough to remember when there wasn't any business in Ireland. And we've moved on considerably since then. And some of the businesses we are seeing on That Great Business Show are fantastic. Finding the cash still remains a pain in the face.
It does. And it shouldn't be so difficult to find. Now, at the same time, there's an awful lot of ideas that come through. So if you think about it, we see 700 inquiries a year into HBAN. We filter that down to about 150 that we think our network will want to see and will invest in. There's no point in us putting companies that are good, but we know our guys just will not invest in. So we try and filter out the ones that we know that the group want. And then from that 150, we get somewhere between 60 and 70 invested in any one year. So we've got a pretty good hit rate. Well, can we do more? Yes. Do we always need no more angels into the group? Yes. What tends to happen is the angels come in, they make 5 to 10 investments, which gives them a good portfolio and a good statistical sort of spread of what they're going to spend it on. But then they go away to look after the babies. And then they want to see the exits. And they got to mine those exits. And then we got to bring new people in and always bring new people in. So yeah, it's a constant need of ours.
What expectations should an angel investor have realistically on return on money, taking the failures, because there will be failures as well, taking that into account? We'll take a number, we'll call it 100,000. You put 100,000 in across a portfolio. What's a good return?
So I think what's come out in the last 5 years, and you said it there that you remember the times when there was no businesses in Ireland. I remember when we started HBAN, which was about 2007, and getting three companies in a room that really deserved private capital was really tough. But equally as tough on the other side was to get three real private investors who really had cash that were really actually going to put it in there. So where it's evolved to now is quite phenomenal where we are now. The way it has evolved is that even 5 or 6 years ago, we would have seen somebody coming in and saying, listen, I've got 250,000. I want to put it on black. And that company there, I like, and I like the team, and I like the sector that they're in. And what we've seen all over the world, in the US and in Europe and here, is that people are now coming in and saying, I've got 250 grand, but what I'd like to do is put 25 grand on 10 different companies. But I want to do it with a syndicate. And the reason I want to do it with a syndicate is because I don't know everything about every sector that I want to invest in. And I like some sectors that I don't fully understand. And I like some teams that I just really like and I don't understand what they're doing, but I like them. But if I'm in with a syndicate and there's 40 other people in this syndicate, generally there's somebody in that syndicate who understands the sector that's been invested in.
Oh, I don't know about that.
And we've seen the flip side of that as well, but generally.
But you haven't told me a number. 100 in, what's a realistic return?
So what we're seeing out of exits, and we've seen 6 exits out of one syndicate last year called Bloom, and they were getting anywhere between 6 and 14 times their money back on the exits now only. Now, when you put the whole lot in as a portfolio,
would you have to?
We haven't matured enough to have a good sense of that, but the research will tell you it's somewhere between 2.5 and 3.5 times your money back.
Which is considerably more than you're going to get in the bank. Or anywhere else.
Well, certainly at the moment it is, yeah. And there's a wall of cash sitting there.
Unless you're crazy enough to put money onto a horse or something like that. But that's not a bad return at all. The one of the people I was talking to before prepping for this is looking to raise cash. And she was telling me an unfair thing that HBAN asks for is a business plan. And just to explain that, people... It's not a business frequently. It's an idea. It's a love. It's a baby. It's something. You still look for a business plan.
Yeah. So by the time they get to us, they need to have a bit more than an idea. So what we have seen over the years, rightly or wrongly, and I'm not saying we're right, is that we have de-risked and our investors are de-risking their investments to the extent that what they like to see is that the tech is majority built and that there's a commercial validation and that there's a customer or two on board to prove and validate that there's a demand for it and also that the pricing structure and everything else works. They're putting their cash into it. The average investment from the HBAN Angels is about 250,000 euros into any one company, but the company itself is getting about 1 million euros. So they're probably a bit more developed than the idea stage. So the pre-revenue companies will find it tough in HBAN. And I put that out there and that's absolutely fine. But that's what that's where we are at.
And do you have I don't expect you to have an answer, but I mean, do you have an answer for that? That is the funding gap. We're back into it again, aren't you? It's just, there isn't, I mean, go back to my horses. People are willing to put 25,000 quid in a horse in this country. They're nuts. Whereas they could actually put 25,000 quid on a company.
So there's two things that's happening at the moment, actually, which we're trying to rectify that. So the pre-revenue and early stage seed, there's definitely a vacuum there. So there's a market failure. And I think we all recognize that. But that's not the place for HBAN to fill that gap. So to be fair, that Enterprise Ireland have just launched a call for a seed venture funds for, I think it's 85 million. So they're calling for people. So that will attract 100 plus million in seed space over the next 5 years. So I think there'll be a bit more there. There's also Dublin Big have a new seed venture fund, which is about 30 million gone out there. And all the existing VCs have some access to seed as well, because they all realize there's a funnel. It's like a sales funnel. You've got to keep that going. The other piece that we're working on, which is with the Alliance, which you may have heard of, which is basically it's Scale Ireland, HBAN, the Irish Venture Capital Association, Tech Ireland, and Euronext, the stock exchange, have all come together and made a submission about EIIS, which is broken.
I was going to say another market failure.
Exactly. And I think, to be fair to the government, they recognise that it is broken and it needs to be fixed.
Yeah, that's only, 2 years ago they were told that, 3 years ago they were told that.
Oh, I've been saying it for a long time, and I'm on record as saying that it's broken and it's not fit for purpose. Make it fit for purpose. Make it easy. Make it simple.
What's the thinking, do you think? Why isn't it fixed just bloody overnight? if there are zillions of euro lying idle on this little island of ours, and the government just doesn't kick ass and just get it fixed.
I think it's political is the answer.
But what's
that? There's far too many people who are saying you're giving rich people tax breaks. Why are you doing that?
Because they can get tax breaks elsewhere and they can go elsewhere
with
their
property,
money. Yeah, exactly. One other lovely thing that I noticed about HBAN is that you have gone, and in fact it tells in your title, you're all island.
We are, for the last 2 years now, and we have an office in Belfast, and the guys in Northern Ireland are absolutely kicking it. They are just knocking down the doors left, right and centre.
There always was an enterprise culture in Northern Ireland, which I'm hoping we have learnt from and DNA'd into ourselves. Ignite NI is very, very active up there.
They are. So our partners up there, the Clarendon Fund Managers, which is CFM, Jim Kern and the team up there, and they are knocking out deals to beat the band.
What is selling, if I can put it that way, at the moment? What's trendy in angel investing?
I suppose a big strength of ours is medtech. We see medtech, it has grown from 23% to 28% last year. And primarily,
now, sorry, let me just put you up on that one, given the small number of deals that might be done, like a jump like that sometimes can just mean one extra deal done, or you know what I mean?
The
maths are always interesting.
It is, and I suppose when you bring the maths back into it, the number of deals done that for medtech would be less, but the quantum of capital that goes into them is an awful lot more.
Mm.
And the companies provide more employment and they sell for a lot more money as well for the exits. But because we have the medtech syndicate down in Galway, who are all deep domain knowledge, and they understand the sector, they understand where the problems are, and they understand what the supply chain is like, and they understand where the exit is going to be. And what we've seen over the years, Conall, is that, like I said, in 2007, getting one individual to invest was tough. Then we saw the syndicates evolving out of that to the extent that we'd have 60 plus people in the Bloom syndicate now. Then we saw syndicates investing with syndicates. So then we saw the medtech syndicate evolve. And then we saw Iris starting to invest with medtech, and Bloom started to invest with medtech, and Bull started to invest with medtech because they saw, we don't understand the sector, but you guys do. We were willing to take a punt on that. And that's got really, really interesting. And now what we're seeing is that we have these international syndicates which are coming out and sort of saying, okay, you've got lead investors in Ireland. They've got, say, if it's a Bloom syndicate, they are putting in 2/3 of the money. You've got due diligence documents available. If you make them available to us, we'll have a look at it in London. We'll have a look at it in New York. We'll have a look at it in Dubai. We'll have a look at it in Singapore. And we recently had a look at it in Vietnam. So there's lots of interesting things happening.
If somebody wants to get involved, and this is the juicy bits now, how much money do you need? How long do you have to leave the money for? How do you pick and choose? How do you get into a syndicate? All of the W5, who, what, when, where, which, why?
Absolutely. So it's info@hban.org. Just ping us an email. It's as simple as that. And one of us will ring you and have a call.
But what is the chat that you have? What is, give me guidance, because somebody may say, God, I'm not big enough for them, or I'm too nervous for that.
Yeah. So first up, it's a high risk investment. Don't think otherwise. Yes, it's great fun. And there's a lot of interesting things that you can learn about the sector, the people, everything else. So there's an awful lot to take with it, but you have to give something back as well.
Meaning?
If you come from the sector, you can actually open up doors. It's not just bringing capital to the table. It's actually opening up a sales book. It's opening up a network. And that's hugely valuable. And that's smart. I mean, that's the smart money.
The great smart money term, yeah.
If I put it back to the amount of money you asked about there, so people always think, oh, you need $1 million to get into that and all that kind of stuff. If I bring that back down, so 75% of the individuals who invested last year, they invested $50,000 or less. Nearly 50% of the people invested $25,000 or less. So you're getting into more reasonable chunks of money that people can sort of go, okay, well, I'm in $20,000-$25,000, I can do that.
And at 25, do you then go into a syndicate, or are they single investments?
Typically into a syndicate.
Okay.
So what we'll see is you might get 10 people doing $25,000 each. So it gives the company $250,000, but not just $250,000 cash. They're also getting $250,000 of brains, networks, and everything else.
And if you haven't got the brains or the network, in other words, but you still love, say, medtech, are you barred?
No, we do accommodate passive investment, and that's absolutely part of it. And one of the things we're looking at now is how do we get the more the 10 grand people in who want to do it? We need the EWIS to work. We need the seed schemes to work. And we need to make it attractive to people to do.
I mentioned that there are billions and billions lying idle in banks at the moment. Did you ever put a finger in the air and wonder how much money might, could possibly be attracted if the right scheme is run?
Yeah, so I think what we will be looking at is somewhere between 25 and 30 million a year that we think we can get in to companies in Ireland.
I bet you that's a modest amount. I bet that, I don't know, there's something about Irish people is once they get a taste for this stuff, is that I think that you might be looking at a considerable amount more. I go back to the races. I just look at fellas and I just think, what in the name of God do you do with your money? Huh? And putting it on Brown Lad or whatever in the 330. Go back to for people who are listening who want to get involved, what's the process in terms of time? If I'm looking at it, say, on a Tuesday, can I get in on a Wednesday? Or do I have to attend meetings? Or do the syndicates sit down and have chats? And so I know they do that in the States.
Yeah, no, we do. So we have an open forum, which is called a forum. And that meets every 4 to 6 weeks. And essentially, it's quite straightforward. So you'll get an invite. It's all done virtually now. We used to hold it in hotels, and we'll probably do a blended version of that because I still think people actually like to meet each other to get a sort of sense of what the trust values are of everybody else around the table. But the virtual one has worked really well. But what happens is you get four companies present, they get a 10-minute presentation, 10-minute Q&A, and then they're out the door. And then you decide whether you want to invest or not. And we'll curate that. We'll ask everybody at the end of it, do you want to invest? And then we'll hook you up with the company. That's called a forum, which is just for individuals. If you're interested in that and you're interested in looking at it further, we have a syndicate. We'll either go to Bloom or depending where you are, we might go West by Northwest out in west of Ireland. We might go to Cork. We might go to Southeast, or we might go to NI. And we put you into a syndicate there, wherever you want to go. I mean, whatever's most appropriate for you. And then you'll meet every 4 to 6 weeks again. You'll get four companies. They'll do a 10-minute presentation, 10-minute Q&A, and then there's a 10-minute round table without the companies involved. So everybody discusses it, and they appoint a lead investor. And the lead investor says, listen, I come from the sector. I understand the problem that they're being solved. I don't know all the answers yet, but let me go away and do some due diligence, and I'll come back and I'll report at the next meeting what my thinkings are or what my findings are. When that person comes back, then they decide, they said, listen, I'm not making a recommendation. I'm just telling you, this is what the market does. This is what the IP is like. This is what the team is like. Here's what the deficits are. Here's what the opportunity is. And then everybody makes their own decision. And they all go, right, I'll put in 15. I'll put in 25. I'll put in 50. I'll put in 100. And then they all come together. And we have to bring that. It's like herding cats then. Because then that stage, you're sort of going, right, there's a lot of people in the mix here. And one of the deals last year had 48 people in it. So you're looking, there's a lot of management and people management that goes into that. But that's where it all happens.
Tell the truth, because we love it, warts and all.
Lots of warts.
Are there any great rows? And in particular, any big blamies? Oh, John told me to go into that. Oh, no, I didn't. Oh, no.
I'm very careful that we don't make recommendations.
Yeah, that's an absolute given. So therefore, you're on your own.
Exactly. And everybody asks me, just give us a nod and a wink on what ones you think will come through for you. And I just find that if you do that, I don't know all the companies and I don't know all the markets that they're going into. And I'm probably pretty poor at picking. So don't ask me. I mean, if you come from the sector, you're going to know more than I am. So I don't pick. Are there fights and are there barnies? Yeah, of course, because you're talking about people's money and you're talking about, and a lot of the times about educating people, which is what we try to do, because what happens is when you start seeing the legal terms and you start seeing the term sheets, they'll go, well, you can't be doing that. Go, well, that's normal terms. So reverse vesting is a normal term. Ratchets are a normal term. It depends on what type of ratchets, and is it weighted average ratchets or the full ratchets and all these things which promoters find new, and they find it really terrifying. And we have to try and explain to them that this is why it's in here and this is why it works.
And actually, I hadn't thought of this, but I presume, does that mean that you have to go and get a blooming, either your accountant and or your lawyer to make sure that you're not being done on the way through?
You'd always have a lawyer involved.
So but is it individual lawyers? And I'll tell you what I'm thinking of. You put in your 25 grand and then you have to probably pay the lawyer another 25 grand.
No, we have capped fees. And when you go in with the syndicate, it's in under one nominee structure. And that's why we do it under that. So everybody rolls in under the same legal terms, the same shareholders agreement, and it's done by one lawyer.
Phew. So, okay, yeah. That makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Final question. Hire in a heartbeat. Who would you like on your team in a heartbeat?
So I was thinking about this. I sort of got like, right, who would be that name? And I thought, actually, the more interesting thing is the profile of that person. What kind of profile do you want? You want somebody with energy, you want somebody with integrity, and you want somebody with the ability to think strategically and act tactically.
Sounds like a footballer.
Not many of them around. And then I was thinking, who are the most impressive speakers when they were presenting? And Mark Little. Is a phenomenal communicator.
Good for you. That's a very interesting one, yeah.
Phenomenal communicator and able to sell a vision.
Yeah.
And
he's done it a few times.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then so Mark on that communication side. And then you had a guy called Kieran O'Connell from DecaWave, just purely on the sales side. And they sold for $400 million last year. So he obviously did a really good job, but the energy coming out of Kieran is phenomenal. And just off the top of my head, they were two, and I'm sure there's plenty more and there's loads of other people. They were just two that when you said it to me, I thought, yeah.
Well, they sound good because they also sound real. Some of the suggestions, I shouldn't be saying this, but somebody did mention Mother Teresa, and I did actually remind the person he knew anyway, but that she was long dead. And the reason that...
You go for the Rose of Tralee,
the reason that Mother Teresa was chosen by this gentleman was he said, quote unquote, to keep him on the straight and narrow. Listen, John Phelan of H-Man, please come back to us when we sort out all the EIIS problems and we'll have another chat, because I'm hoping that what you're doing and what others are doing in the sector will finally change, because we know so many brilliant companies that just need cash to be even more brilliant. John Phelan of H-Man, thanks so much for joining us on That Great Business Show.
Thanks for having me, Conall.
Looking for the best work-life balance? Why not start your new business life in one of Ireland's beautiful Gaeltacht locations? Uadhrás na Gaeltachta has created Ireland's biggest digital hub, G-Tech. High-speed broadband just for you. Cosail no ifnachtlat. Your new work-life awaits. Find out more at uadhrás.ie. Backing great women-led businesses on every show.
We started today's podcast with Perry Como singing about Christmas, even though we're not even in May yet. But now is the time that big retailers are beginning to think about the real Christmas. I learned this week that the iconic Arnott's store in Dublin City Centre gets a whopping 6 million customers every year. And I also learned that Arnott's have launched an initiative to get smaller Irish brands and products in front of those shoppers via their Pitch 21 promotion. The aim of that initiative is to support Irish designers, makers and entrepreneurs across fashion, beauty, lifestyle, home and technology. People who already have a product or range developed, as well as winning some cash. I think the big win for those who are chosen is that you get Arnott's retailing know-how and mentoring. And regular listeners to the podcast know how much we love mentors. Audrey Owen is Arnott's Director of Innovation and Enterprise and joins me now on That Great Business Show. Hi, Audrey.
Hi, Conall. How are you?
I'm very well. And I'm even happier that I'm hoping that we're finally getting out of COVID and in great time for Christmas of this year, 2021.
Correct.
And if we can get that, you want 5 great businesses to be front and centre in your store. Who, what kind of businesses could they be?
I suppose, Conall, when we think of Arnott's, we always say Arnott's is a store that is about around every corner. You'll always find something interesting, and it's a store really for discovery. And in terms of what we're looking for brands that are sustainable, that are creative, that are really going to connect with our customers, and I think also that are really going to be inspiring, and ultimately, this is a Christmas opportunity, so they need to be gifting products primarily. But yeah.
Now, you mentioned to me off air that you have 6 million customers. I just find that phenomenal.
I know, it is phenomenal.
Like, it is a single store. I know. It's a massive store.
It is a massive store. And what people don't realise is the store is actually 290,000 square feet. So,
you know why? Because nobody understands what that means. But I just go into it and you actually can get lost.
You can get lost.
I have.
And I think the great thing about the store, yeah, it's our annual footfall would be around 6 million. I mean, the month of December in 2019, we welcomed over 1 million people into the store and we have a conversion of 40% on average. Okay, but last
and
year...
In plain language, that means that 40% of them actually put their hands in their pockets and
Correct. And last year in the month of December, where it was in the midst of COVID, that went up to 60%. So... yeah, we have an incredible footfall. And I suppose the one thing about Arnott's, it's the breadth of offer. And it really is a store, like I said, that you can discover something interesting and innovative around every corner.
If you can get it, find the exit door, of course, because it's so big. It really is. I love it. But why is Arnott's decide? Why did you decide on this?
Well, I think we all know people over the last year who've had to, for whatever reason, do something different, had to reinvent themselves. And I think we can all say out of a crisis, you know, people need to be or want to be entrepreneurial. And as a team of people, we really recognised that it was, you know, it was something that we felt we wanted to get involved in and offer brands a platform to come into the store where we feel we can really make a difference. We have a great team of people in the store, whether it's on creative, whether it's on the commercial side, IT, PR, marketing. And we felt we really can support brands, getting them to the point where they can optimize their potential.
And one thing you told me is you're pretty blunt and that you will tell people if their product isn't good enough.
Yeah, I think it's really important when I see, you know, I suppose one thing, Conall, what I do is everybody who approaches me, I always want to see them, okay? Because you never know where a conversation can lead. So somebody will come in and they'll start pitching their product, but actually when you start talking to them, you might find that their experience is in a different area or there's something else that they've done that might be of interest. So I always see every single person or I always have a call with them. And sometimes people come and say, look, I have a great idea and this is what I want to do and I'm going to leave my job. And you just kind of have to have a conversation saying, well, maybe the best thing you can do is not do that because, you know, our experience is maybe that particular area is tight, you know, it's oversubscribed. It's just, you know, it's been done before. It's difficult, you know, it's difficult to make money. And yeah, so we've had those conversations, but also we've had people who have had pop-ups in our business and have said after trading saying, okay, what I learned here was actually I don't want to go ahead. And this has been an amazing learning experience. So it is, I think that's the one thing about retail. People need to understand how it really, really works. You know, retail can be, you know, difficult. And I think the great thing is you come in and you work with us and you get a really rounded experience. And I always say, like in a meeting, ask all the stupid questions because don't be afraid. Because
there are no stupid questions.
There are no stupid questions, exactly. And I always say to people, you know, I'm on the phone. There's no problem. Like, you know, if you've got a problem on a Saturday where, you know, somebody hasn't turned up or there's an issue with your delivery, you know, let us know. I always say to people, I don't want to be the one to discover a problem. You need to tell me about the problem and then we'll try and sort it out.
You are going to be very busy. If you're so open and so chatty with their or potential
my
customers,
my kids won't be happy, or my
One of the things that I have chatted to people about this. First of all, the reaction to the initiative is fantastic because people who might be on what we call Team GBS, followers of the show, have been on to me, and I told them that you're coming on. And one of the questions is that one company was concerned that they needed to have a big social media following.
No.
These are just perceptions that you feel, that they felt that maybe Arnott's wants to leverage off them.
No, and you know what? I don't think so. Like, my starting point with everything, it's about the product or it's about the experience. So that's where we always start. So it's not about... And it's about the passion that you have for your brand as well. So I think you have to park all that because some brands will have an amazing social following, but you might look at the product and might be right. Like, so that is a consideration for, but it's not the consideration. The consideration always has to be the product and the experience, that undoubtedly, and how it's made and how it's all put together. but that's what our customers see.
And you have to do a video pitch as well,
yeah.
Correct? Yeah. And that was putting people off because they felt that, again, unless they were experienced.
Oh my God, no. Like, I mean, I think, and that was my idea. because I thought it was really good. I thought it was really important to actually just to see the people who are putting forward their ideas.
I agree with you. And connect.
Yeah. And I get it because actually I hate videos. I hate anything like that. But actually, I totally love podcasts. But I think it's really important for people when they do that. It's about communicating what your brand is and
passion.
And their passion and yep. Tell the story. You know, like we love the story as well. And I just said when we were working through the application form, you know, something in black and white doesn't sell it, you know. Somebody communicating tells it. So I wouldn't have any concerns on that. Like I'm, you know, that's not my area. It's like I said, it's back to the product.
And to get people to apply, there is a very short deadline.
It's not really. It's like this, it's the application process is really, you know, is really quick. So get your applications in. It's the 7th of May and is our application deadline.
That's a week from our broadcast time.
Yeah.
But how quick is the application, would you say?
Oh, like, I mean, okay, you have to upload the video, but like it's, you know, we designed it actually because I'm allergic to, you know, cumbersome application forms. So we wanted to make it really simple and straightforward. So it is, I feel it's very easy. I don't think there's an issue. If you want to apply, it shouldn't take you longer than 10 minutes.
It'll be out of time, but I did see today that Leo Carlo are actually doing a skills thing about making videos for your business.
Yeah.
So anybody should get onto Leo Carlo.
Yeah.
And one of the things we've learned on this podcast is that if whether you're in Donegal or Kerry, you can still nip into the
local one. I heard that actually, and I'm living in Carlo, and I heard your recent podcast about one of the
Hackettstown has given me all of that.
Yeah.
And we're going to have more, I hope.
Yeah.
Back to business here is typically what kind of a business? I know you told me sustainable and it's giftable fashion. You're wearing a white shirt.
Yeah.
Would that work?
You know what? If it has a point of difference, it is about what's going to be, what is the gap in the market? What do you, you know, I go around sometimes and I always have ideas and it's things that I can't get or things that inspire me. Or things that you think will resonate with, you know, when you're trying to buy something for a family member and you go, God, if this was available. So, you know, I don't have the answer because what I want to do is I want somebody to surprise me what they feel is an opportunity or what they've seen a gap or what they're passionate about.
And best-selling items in your store, and I'm not expecting you to have a little list of them, but are you selling more fashion? Or, I mean, I saw on the list of things that you're looking for, technology. What kind of technology could you be looking for? People aren't making TVs or anything here. I don't even know what it might be.
I think on a technology side of things, it could be an app where it could be a service related app that we could look, you know, it's things like that.
Okay. I wouldn't have thought of that, but that's nice.
You know,
it's,
I think for us, it's, we put down technology. Technology is a big area for us. And it's like you said, I'm not expecting somebody's going to present a TV, but if they come in and present, you know, it could be a sustainable solution that's built around technology.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? So,
I do.
You know, like we see like circular retail is a really important part of our business. So, it could be technology linked into a sustainability solution that could be presented to us. So it's that type of idea that.
You have your deadline on when people will apply. How many are we into hundreds of applications, or will you go further than that? I mean, there's no way that you can look at 1,000.
No, we can't. But I think put it this way: prior to launching Pitch 21. As a team, we sat down and we said, okay, what do we want to achieve? What do we feel is a good result on applications? And we've well exceeded that.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it is good. We're really happy with it.
It's very, how could I put it diplomatically? It's not a number, is it?
Not a number. It's not a number, but we are really, really happy with what we have.
When the applications go in, then say we'll make up a number of 200 people apply, and then what's the process after that?
So the process is after the 7th of May. So what we will do is we will review all the applications.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, good luck with that. No, I'm really excited. I love that. I'm really looking forward to that part of it. And then on around the 21st of May, we'll be in touch with a short list of finalists, and we'll be then scheduling for those finalists to come in and present their brand or product. And then in...
What form does that take? Is that a half hour pitch or...
It's actually going to be in Arnott's. So they'll be coming in talking through their product, and the panel of judges, including myself, will just talk to them. I mean, it's not a daunting pro, you know, it's not like we're saying, you know, I don't want to like a dragon's den. It's not like that. It's just come in, tell us about your product, what you want to do, what's your vision, where you need help. You know, we don't want it to be daunting. It's, but yeah, I think that's...
And out of that, you will choose five.
Out of that, we would choose five, yeah.
And those five get the big one, which is, there's cash for an overall winner. We'll get to that in a second. But those five are guaranteed to go into the store
for
Christmas.
Yeah.
1 million people.
1 million people.
That is fantastic.
And 1 million people.
I'd say it'd be more because post-COVID.
Yeah. I mean, what they're also going to get is, it's the mentorship, and we've great judges. You know, PR, marketing, I had a meeting this morning with Donald McDonald, who's our MD, and we were just talking, we were giving him an update on this. And this is such an important project. We just said, whatever it takes, okay, we want everybody who's involved in this project with us to go away and say, okay, that was fantastic. We learned so much, and we had a really good experience working with the team in Arnott's, and we want to get it, you know, we want to get it right for the brands coming in.
And one of the things you told me off air was that you will be mentoring them on things like design and packaging and stuff like that. Is there enough time between May and December to get everything right?
Yeah. And there is, because Conall, it's like anything. If you want to make it happen, you make it happen. So, you know, that's it. I wouldn't be worried about that kind of thing, because we've worked against the clock before. So it's all about identifying what the problem is and then getting it sorted.
And say we are making white shirts, we mentioned before. How many white shirts must you have in stock? Because if a million people come in and try to buy a million white shirts, that's a problem.
Yeah, well, you know, great if a million people did come in. We'd be very happy with that that result. But no, it's all down to, you know, there's so many considerations, right? It depends on pricing. It depends on the size of the floor, you know, of the area that they occupy, whether it's ground floor, first floor, you know, the PR, the marketing, the story, all of those things, you know. There's not one piece. It's a whole jigsaw puzzle of considerations that go into making up what you feel a brand will sell.
Now, I'm only thinking of the problems, but if somebody is already selling in either boutiques or in other shops, any problems?
You know, ideally, like if they're already selling in a store or a boutique, it's not, you know, it's not an issue. But I think for us, if they've got like some type of, you know, they need to have some selling at the moment anyway. So that's important. But
let's just pick up on that, because again, to amplify or to clarify on that one, selling already, like you could be selling three of something. Do you need proper producing?
Depends on the product.
Okay.
I mean that, like, and I'm not trying to, it really depends, you know, it could be paintings, you know, it could be...
That's a gift item, all right.
You know what I mean? It could be, I won't say, like, as you said, technology, but I don't think you can't be prescriptive and say that, because you will look at everything and assess it on the criteria that we've set.
So let's do our market research here for those people who will apply. Who or what is your typical customer in Arnott's, and their age profile, demographics, all that good stuff?
Okay, so 85% of our customers are female. 75%.
That's actually curious. 85. I would have thought it was lower. In other words, more men.
No.
I like it as a store. It's just.
Yeah.
Know.
Well, that's in terms of a. Yeah. And 75% of our customers are Dublin based.
Okay.
If we look at our age profile, around 40% of our customers are between the ages of 35 and 50. but in saying that the fastest growing age group would be within 18 to 24.
Okay. And what are they buying, the younger people?
Beauty, big gateway into like our beauty brands. So, you know, beauty is such a really strong category. We've, you know, an incredible lineup of brands, whether it's, you know, Charlotte Tilbury or Kiehl's or Jo Malone. We've, you know, Beauty Hub.
I hope you have Sculpted by Amy, because she's been in here. And who else has been in here? Jo Brown?
Yeah.
We've had four of... there's Moxie Loves.
Yes.
I'm trying to remember all the lovely brands that have come in here. I hope they're all being carried by Arnott's, because otherwise you won't be back in Team GBS. So the other nice thing that we mentioned, one person will get 10 grand in cash, hard cash, nice cash.
Yeah, for their business.
That's very nice.
Yeah,
well, they'll say it's for the business, but I say it's for the party afterwards. And that comes after Christmas.
So that comes after Christmas.
You go in for Christmas, you have a great time, you sell out, and then you get 10 grand afterwards.
Yeah, but I suppose just to say, Con, it's not that we're kind of you know, the criteria for the 10,000 euro, it's not purely going to, it's not who sells the most. It's a collective, you know, a collective considerations around.
Who makes the biggest effort?
Yeah, well, you know, it is. It's where we feel in terms of effort, you know, opportunity, scope. It's not just about who turns over the most money in the space.
And for those who don't know it, Arnott is associated with Brent Thomas.
That's right.
And if there were a very successful, we'll go back to my white shirt, a very successful white shirt in Arnott's. Any chance that it might move over to Brent Thomas? And after that, because it's an international business, of course.
Yeah, I mean, I think one thing is about our business. I've lots of examples of brands that have come in to, that started off in Arnott's and working and then have extended into Brent Thomas and vice versa. There's brands that are in Brent Thomas and now are in Arnott's. So yes, of course, that is 100% an opportunity.
I love it. I saw it and I said, must chat to you about this, and I find out more about it. And because I think that anything that promotes business, particularly smaller businesses, and particularly areas like textiles that we had Annalise on from the linen shirt company.
Yeah.
Those kinds of businesses, I just love them so much, because it's something new and novel and distinctly Irish as well, which is nice.
And we love working, and we love Irish brands, and we like working with, you know, we love working with the smaller brands as well.
Good. Well, your final question to... this would be very relieving for you that you finally finished the interrogation. Hire in a heartbeat. Who would you hire in a heartbeat?
Hire in a heartbeat. So that would be Sarah Blakely, who is the founder of Spanx.
Oh, yeah.
And I suppose just to say with... well, first of all, okay, Spanx is in Brent Thomas and Arnott's, and it's a really, really big brand for our business. But what I really admire about Sarah is, first of all, she set up a brand with $5,000, and she was the youngest ever self-made billionaire. So what's not to love about that? And has constantly evolved her business and pivoted and brought in new products. And I think anybody would like her in the team.
And I'm strange, and I look at the stocks and shares every day in the paper, and I think that I saw this week that they've had a fantastic rise in share price. I think I saw that. I'm not sure if they are quoted or not, but I thought I saw that, which means that they must be doing something brilliant as well. They must be selling superbly well. Sarah Blakely, we'll get her onto the team, and we'll introduce her to the winner of your competition. Final question. 6th, 7th of May? The 7th. Closing day, 7th of May. Okay, we'll trigger people in for that. That is Audrey Owens of Arnott's. Thank you so much for joining us on
that. Thank you so much for having me on. I really appreciate it.
Oh, we love it, because it's, as I said, a great initiative. That's it from That Great Business Show, episode 32. Sound engineer Keith Starrs was twiddling his tweeter and wobbling his woofer to make us sound incroyable. Peter Rice will add some further fairy dust in post-production. This week, shout-outs are for Paula Fitzsimons, who directed us to Eatto, and Jeananne O'Brien. Sarah Jane Tobin sent us Angel John Phelan. My thanks to Maeve O'Higgins for helping line up Audrey Owens from Arnott's. And John O'Loughlin at the British Embassy made the initial contact regarding Pat O'Connor. Buachas Liv Fad. If you want to be featured on That Great Business Show, send your details to us via the website thatgreatbusinessshow.com. And if you'd like to advertise on Ireland's best business podcast, email producer@thatgreatbusinessshow.com and have a chat. Finally, our thanks to our sponsor, De Facto Shave. Try their world's best shaving oil for just a week and you will be a convert for men and women. It leaves skin soft, smooth and nick-free. Try it, you'll like it. Keith Starrs loves it. So, from me, Conall O Morain, we'll talk again next week on That Great Business Show, Slán Tumult.